this do a very brief introduction of Lori. Lori Grace is the founder and director of the Sunrise Center in Corte Madera, which she founded about 20 years ago. She also manages the Hale Akua Garden Farm, an organic farm and retreat center on Maui. I'd like to go there someday. Other projects include election integrity work, Save Our Bay, Marin Clean Energy, and support for California's Proposition 37, which could have required labeling of genetically modified organisms in food. Lori has been an active member of the Sierra Club, NRDC, EDF, and the Union of Concerned Scientists. For the last 3 years, she has been working with Don Huber, PhD, an international glyphosate expert concerned about the damaging effect this herbicide has on the health of humans, mammals, invertebrates, and native plants of Marin. I just met Lori 3 weeks ago, and I heard her give a talk at the retirement center, at the Redwoods Retirement Center, and her talk triggered old memories for me. 48 years ago, I was on a supply ship off the coast of Vietnam, and I watched strings of helicopters saturating that beautiful tropical country with millions and millions of gallons of Agent Orange. We now know what the effects of that were. We didn't know then, but you'll see some of the most disturbing pictures of the downside of that process. And I want you to know that I worked in the Napa Valley for a number of years, from 2001 to 2009, and a derivative of Agent Orange is used in the Napa Valley, throughout the valley, most beautiful valley. On the one winery where I worked, we would bring in truckloads of Roundup in 50-gallon drums, truckloads, and that was applied year after year after year. Long-term effects, we don't know. Recent report on breast cancer rates in Marin County suggests that some Marin women have a genetic predisposition to breast cancer, and that they might consume more alcohol than the average woman. No connection with environmental causes. I think we need to do more studies. It's really like blaming the victim. You know, you have breast cancer, bad person. Yeah. So watch your show. Consider a very important vote that's coming up for a board member. The incumbent supports the use, is considering the use of Roundup in the watershed. Her opponent, who happens to be in this room, is definitely against the use of Roundup in the watershed.
So I want to say that this slideshow, this PowerPoint, is a living document. It changes every time. And it changed again when Larry sent me the results of his research that he tried to have published at Spotswood, in Spotswood's column in the Marin Independent Journal, where he had outlined the pages in the draft EIR that that recommends spraying. Now I read it also, you know, at one point. But it reflected to me what I have to say is the doublespeak that I've received from Liza Cross, who is running against Larry in this district, actually, in Fairfax, San Geronimo, Kentfield, Larkspur, Greenbrae. And that is that she told me that she wanted me to make sure in a private meeting when I met with her and her staff that there was no helicopter spraying. I said, I never imagined there was helicopter spraying. And now she says on her latest flyer that she opposes the spraying of herbicides. Well, there is, in front of her staff, she admitted to backpack spraying. And it would have to be pretty pressurized to get up on those steep cliffs. Sponging, which I'll go into. But I was happy to get your things, although a little bit sad, you know, both, because I was happy to get it because it showed me something about the doublespeak that I'd heard in my private meeting with her, and it it's something that needed to be brought out, so I spent time working on that. And also, Larry, you sent me this alternative plan developed by the Presidio Business School of a whole nother way to work with the Marin Water District situation. And so what you come across to me is as a man who studies the situation. And one last thing is when I told Lisa and her staff that in serpentine soils, which we have in Marin, the application of glyphosate could be like it is in Sri Lanka, where we have 25,000 deaths of unknown origin kidney disease. So, I mean, 700 kidney disease deaths, 25,000 people were afflicted with kidney disease of unknown origin. Her response to me is, well, send me the study. Well, I can send her the study. It's in my bibliography of 74 medical and environmental journals. But I said to myself, well, send me the study. How much of this is going to be an intellectual manipulation with studies, and how much is going to be a place of using the precautionary principle? So anyway, after my brief editorial comments like that, I'm going to go on with the slideshow. So we haven't sprayed herbicides in the Marin Water District, as far as we know, as of 2005. There are significant, in the Water District, there is significant fire hazard. And I went with Larry Bradman, Don Huber, an international glyphosate recovery expert who's flown all over the United the world, actually, by countries to rescue their countries from the health and environmental hazards caused by glyphosate. But anyway, we were walking, and I was really impressed with Larry's willingness to really study a situation with an expert, to put in a lot of his time on one day. These are the broom plants. Some of them are 6 feet tall. This is one surrounding a dying tree. And this is us looking up a big slope like this of Phytophthora that, a big stand hill of Scotch broom and French broom, which if sprayed, we'd have to use a lot of glyphosate and could possibly come down and help kill the oak underneath because further down, because it weakens the oak's immune system and promotes the growth of harmful bacteria. This is one of the plans for controlling the fuel load in the Marin Water District. Aquamaster is glyphosate together with Competitor. Competitor is an oily surfactant, and it has it's equally dangerous and helps make Aquamaster even more dangerous for people walking by or the worker applying it. And so it's dangerous because it's an extremely powerful mineral chelator that damages human and animal health. It was patented originally by Monsanto as an antibiotic, and they bought it from a company that created it as a boiler cleaner. Glyphosate is very dangerous for plants. It's able to travel far beyond where it's sprayed, through the roots of plants, dust particles, mist, and rain. And it's bad for the environment, as I said before, because it discourages and healthy bacteria like Pseudomonas and Bacillus, and it increases unhealthy bacteria and fungi. It leaks into aquifers. It's not biodegradable, in contrast to what the Marin County Water Department thinks. And it is increases fire danger by diminishing the immune system of plants, also diminishes the ability of all plants to absorb water, and therefore that creates very dry plants and increased fire risk. It's actively used in the San Francisco Bay and in Marin. Here's they were doing this in the Presidio. You notice that they're not wearing a respirator. This will become more of concern when you see what medical studies I dug up. Another around up spraying in the Bay Area Park. Here's a Marin woman spraying Roundup in her garden, and if you notice, this is called a backpack sprayer. Those are the ones that Lisa Cross told me that they would probably be using if they could find out, which they were pretty sure they could, that that Roundup was safe. And the Marin Open Space and Marin Parks have been using it in limited quantities, and they believe that it's safe, and they talk to each other all the time. So now taking a look at, all right, where's Roundup currently sprayed in Marin? It's sprayed by Caltrans around the Marin Civic Center, around schools, and around the, and it's being proposed for around the edges of the Marin Water District reservoirs and hiking trails. And the in Caltrans in about 2011, the Caltrans workers objected that they had been horrifically sickened and wanted to come forward to talk about the permanent harms they suffered as a result of being ordered to spray chemicals for a living. Here's some Roundup sprayed on a Marin County road.
What's the relationship between Roundup and glyphosate?
By the way, I noticed some people are straining to see the slideshow. Can I move this back?
Yes, that would be great.
Yeah.
There's another chair here and another seat up here.
We need to speak up a little more loudly also.
Oh, thank you for showing me.
There are several of us here.
Okay. I'll talk like this.
Yeah.
All right. So I wonder how much I need to review that I
got. You got it, really.
I hope so. Okay, so I always show the results of where I get my data, and this came from something called the Vegan Reader, and originally the work of Paul Apfel. Roundup can also be spread in dust, and when you have a surfactant in it,
we also question what the relationship was between Roundup and glyphosate.
Oh, thank you. Glyphosate is the active ingredient in Roundup.
Okay.
It's also the active ingredient in Aquamaster, which is really the same as Roundup. I will go to the next slide and talk about that. But it can be spread through dust and rainwater. So the ones that are being considered by the Marin Water District right now are Aquamaster, Garlon, and Transline. Aquamaster is by far considered the most powerful one and is used with broom. And the idea is that it reduces fire danger, in their opinion. And Aquamaster is the proposed herbicide marketed by Dow Chemical in cooperation with Monsanto. It is only supposed to be used around bodies of water in with 2 miles per hour or lower wind. And I don't know how many times we have that in the Marin Water District. And only on a clear day, because it can merge with fog particles and then travel. Okay. This is actually Aquamaster is produced by Monsanto. You can see this. And by the way, their limit of liability on damages is they will refund the cost of the bottle. And that's what I printed here. Okay. That's the same for Competitor, by the way. Competitor, here it is, that this is supposed to reduce herbicide drift and help reduce Aquamaster drift. It is just as dangerous or more dangerous than Roundup, and it would be mixed with Roundup so that there would be less drift. But I have to tell you, I felt concerned when I looked at the Competitor label on the web, because it said, if on skin or clothing, take off contaminated clothing, rinse skin immediately with plenty of water for 15 to 20 minutes. Call a poison control center or doctor for treatment advice. If inhaled, move the person to fresh air. If the person is not breathing, call Call 911 or an ambulance. Then give artificial respiration, preferably mouth to mouth if possible. Call a poison control center or doctor for further treatment advice. I mean, I'm stunned. I'm stunned that something like this would be used around our water. Stunned. And also, think of the danger to the people who are working. This is one last picture of results of spraying Roundup in Sonoma County. The history about how glyphosate's biodegradability is hidden is basically that both France and New York sued Monsanto on its claim that Roundup was biodegradable and environmentally friendly. When Roundup lost the lawsuit in both places, they sold it to many other weed killer companies, including Dow, and they were not prevented from calling it they could call theirs biodegradable and environmentally friendly. And in fact, the competitor, one that I just told you, on its label, it says it's environmentally friendly. If we're in the place, something where if you're not breathing, apply artificial respiration, this is not what I call artificial, you know, friendly, whether it's for humans or animals in the area. There was a study by the Marin Water District on the non-biodegradability of glyphosate, and basically it was only run for 3 months, and the Scotch broom is still up there living. And what Don Huber tells me, and he's one of the glyphosate recovery experts that we had here, is there can be an estimated life of Roundup or Aquamaster in the soil 22 years. This year, the Germans did not buy 1 million pounds of California almonds because they had too much glyphosate in them. The trees had not been sprayed in 2 years. Mm. So guess who they were sold to? The Americans, okay? All right, this is from their study. If you notice, this is why they thought that it was biodegradable. These are their lines, okay? But if glyphosate went down because it was bonding with the minerals in the soil. If glyphosate was really degrading, we would have seen a line like this in AMPA. Okay? This is the study that the Marin Water District and Janet Klein believe in is a key proof that glyphosate is biodegradable. And so there are a number of mistakes that were made. Janet Klein also thought that competitor didn't have POEA in it, and basically it does. Instead of having phenoxylated tallowamine, it has phenoxylated ester, which means it's a fat. Okay? So there are some mistakes that could have major consequences for us here. It's a pervasive contaminant. It can join the water cycle. It's highly soluble. And as I said, it can spread as pesticide drift. Here's a picture of the water cycle. You haven't seen it since fifth grade or whatever, you know. And you can see it can evaporate, go in clouds and come down as rain. It can go into our aquifer. It goes into lakes and streams, okay? It's runoff. All right, so just one more. Okay, this is the first thing that concerned me in 2012. Herbicides found in human urine. They were found in human urine, urban Germans only, 5 to 20 times above the legal drinking limit for glyphosate in drinking water in the European Union. Okay? So they don't eat GMOs like we do in Kellogg's Corn Flakes or or Cheerios or a variety, you know, corn soy products of many sorts. And so recent testing that I've done has been showing up 10 times the amount of glyphosate in American urine and breast milk than in, and I've been working with two other nonprofits in this, than Europeans. Can most people hear me at this point? Should I? Okay. So I always try to show things, you know, the sources, and my bibliography shows many more. This is some of the stuff where they found it in 41% of samples of in water samples, groundwater in northeast Spain. This was actually a U.S. geologic study, one of the few, where they showed that it was showing up in Indiana, Mississippi, and Iowa. Now, you might say, oh, here in Marin County, we don't grow GMO crops, so we don't have to worry about this. Well, I want to let you know, when we took a walk and when I studied the label for Aquamaster, in order to get Scotch broom, which has a woody stem, you have to spray much more than you would spray or dab or sponge on a GMO crop. And this was confirmed to me by Don Huber, okay? This is, again, the sources in environmental toxicology and chemistry. So it also promotes other plants, and we have a nature in its inevitable creativity is becoming able to create weeds that survive Scotch and French broom, which is why we had the recent EPA approval of Ensure, which has 2,4-D in it, just 2 days ago. That mixes glyphosate and 2,4-D. And here's a picture of the kind of weed that comes up with the spraying of glyphosate. It has a stem as thick as a small human forearm. It can grow up to 4 inches per night.
Jeez.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, or a day as well. Well, you know, per day, rather than a better way. This is a whole field taken over by glyphosate where the farmer abandoned it. I mean, by pigweed where the farmer abandoned it. And now we have pigweed coming into California. And in fact, to my astonishment, I found one in my own garden. It's been pulled out. Now, there's concerns among Marin beekeepers, and they told me, I know Bonnie of the beekeepers, and she's very concerned about the possible spraying in the water district, because you can get many dead bees from spraying glyphosate. And the reason why is that honeybees, bumblebees, and other pollinators require lactobacillus and bifidobacterium to digest honey. And glyphosate was originally patented as an antibiotic. That's why it has an antibiotic effect, because it pulls minerals out of the human, animal, or plant. And this could also have a very significant effect on amphibians, lizards, and fish, including salmon. I made sure that this is a picture here of fish that were impacted by the spraying of glyphosate, a frog. Now, we're moving a little bit more fully into the danger to human and animal health. This is one of the things that surprised me, and when I talked to the Marin Parks and to the Water District, I said, why aren't you wearing a respirator? And they said, respirator? Why, the company label doesn't say to use a respirator. Well, here is why I wondered this. Breathing Roundup can cause, or Aquamaster for that matter, can cause precancerous DNA changes within 20 minutes at 1/450th of what is sprayed for heavy weed control. And when I went to the Beyond Pesticides conference, they didn't know about it. They asked me for the study. This is a study for all of you who are interested. The Archives of Toxicology. And unfortunately, what what's true is many of the journal articles that I quote are from Germany, China, Costa Rica, France, Sri Lanka, and India, because Monsanto has a very strong control on information flow here in the United States. This is on the overgrowth of deadly fungal toxins that can grow in glyphosate-treated soil, where they will enhance Aspergillus section, where they will increase the, this is a little dog that died, almost died, when it was walking with its near a Roundup sprayed field in the Midwest, and it had licked some of the stuff that it got on its paw. And so it was being treated in a hospital. Just recently, and I said my slideshow is always alive, sponsored by, I found out a woman from Nevada wrote me about six fawns that she saw with severe birth defects that couldn't nurse on the mother and died. Seemed an older woman, she wrote in handwriting, I'm not used to that, but it was good. So I started looking into it together with Don Huber, and now in places, parks in Montana, including Mount Rainier Park, and some of the nearby forests, they are noticing deformed testicles and underbites, and now they're noticing even more elk hoof disease in Montana forests. So just imagine seeing dead fawns in the Marin Water District or elks, and we don't want this, okay? Now moving back to humans, maybe I can move further? Okay. Moving back into humans, we have the effect of testosterone, and this is going to get worse as time goes on. We'll start with this one. On male genitalia and testosterone levels, it's found to destroy testosterone and male fertility. At higher concentrations, Roundup is shown to induce testicular cell death in as little as 1 hour, and typically no later than 48 hours after exposure. It also has a very bad effect on sperm, and this is perhaps why. The GM soy-fed testicles, as you see, are on the right. The control on the left, very different. These are all nascent sperm cells. You can see very few in here. Okay. And then these are, this is a study that talked about the changes in male genitalia. Glyphosate is an endocrine disruptor at very small amounts, actually one part per trillion. This is increasing in the United States. This is called hypospadia. This little boy is urinating out of a hole here underneath, a little bit more like a female. This is just a diagram to make it clear. Also note the very small penis size. As a mother of my son, if he had gone with that, I would have felt very sad. There's a study on the testicular and testosterone, and Elsevier is a European journal. So, as an American, typical journalists, when they review something, they don't go to Google Scholar. That's where you can start to find this stuff, finally. And people don't do a lot of research in international journals. And, typical writers, like I even remember one at the LA Times, was just using American information that he got off Google. And I tell you, it's really filtered. Okay, here is now a little note on kidney disease. We're going to gradually get worse. All right, 25,000 people in Sri Lanka, as I said before, kidney disease and Roundup. And 700 have died as of this year. And what happened is they started noticing that this was showing up in their workers in areas sprayed with glyphosate. And the whole government freaked out initially. They said, no, we will ban it throughout the whole country. No Roundup allowed in this country at all. And then they analyzed it and found that it was occurring in the places where they had serpentine soils, which is what we have in Marin. This is an example of the kidney damage. As you notice, this becomes inflamed and very bulbar. This is a normal human kidney. And what we're finding is that Roundup is toxic to human DNA, even when diluted in concentrations 450% lower than in agricultural or landscaping applications. And this POEA is a big part of it, the one that's in the competitor that's being proposed. Okay? Here's the liver damage. Again, notice the inflammation here, normal human liver. And yes?
What is the actual connection between glyphosate? Glyphosate and serpentine soils?
I'll go into that in a little while. Okay. Yeah, thank you. Good question. Okay, this is just the study where they found that it was causing cell death in human liver cells. Note that this is the University of Buenos Aires. Argentina had taken on using glyphosate to some significant degree. I'm not going to go through this very much, but this is about the information suppression in the United States. And these many scientists have lost their jobs when they have brought forward the dangers of either GE foods or here's Ignacio Chapella, right from the University of California, Berkeley, almost lost his tenure. Don Huber had his own risks. And then we get to a very severe attack on Andres Carrasco, who was taking information to a conference on birth defects in Argentina, which had become so numerous. He was with three other scientists in a car. They stopped at a stop sign. An angry mob of people came out and stoned his car at the stop sign. One scientist was made a paraplegic by the damage. And we'll go into his results, his research in just a moment. Seralini is another person who had his study initially removed by Monsanto. Monsanto put someone on the editorial board. So it's gotten republished. When I went to the Beyond Pesticides conference in Oregon, I met Michael Skinner, who talks about how damage from pesticides can be in humans, can go all the way down, and also animals, can go all the way down a line, not just to your children, but to your grandchildren. And it's called epigenetics, something that I'm learning about. And so now we're getting to some very heavy-duty stuff. And I'll tell those of you who don't want to see the birth defects, including in the United States, I'll warn you so you can close your eyes if you want to. But one of the main reasons that all these countries are limiting their use of glyphosate is not in addition to the kidney disease, it's also the birth defects. And I first learned about this in 2012, and it was actually very hard in 2012 to find out about it. And when I was trying to find out about it, mostly what I found was material in Spanish, and I don't speak Spanish, so that was a bit of a problem. But Don Huber helped me find the first selection of birth defect babies. Now, going further into some other slides, and you can close your eyes if you want at this one. For those of you who need to want to keep your eyes open, the possibility of having no arms or legs is significant. The growth of the brain outside the skull, and this is hydrocephaly. Head things are really significant. Now that's the end of those birth defects, more to follow. This Colombian child was sprayed by mistake with glyphosate and had terrible lesions. And this is a study, again, from a European journal about how tetragenic effects, which means the changes in the genes of the baby, divergence of regulatory decisions from scientific evidence. This is very true here in the United States. This was a study just in 2011 where they found these insecticide proteins and AMPA and glyphosate in the blood and urine of pregnant women and the baby's cord blood. This is from Bali, Indonesia. This is placenta of a normal woman. This is the placenta of a woman who was eating GMO tofu, so getting significant amounts of glyphosate. And there's a whole new vessel that goes around the cord. The baby has significantly lower Agpar scores. Now, we have, unfortunately, in our country, the government is married to our herbicide companies. And so this is a problem. And it's shown in a number of different ways. Millions of pounds of Roundup are sprayed each year. It's considered as safe as aspirin. That's actually a quote from a Monsanto biologist from about 1985. And so getting back to Andres Carrasco, who was the first one to point out birth defects. If you see here, they're in the control. This is a normally developing tadpole. Do you see how the head is a lot smaller here and the eyes are uneven? These are the leg buds for the tadpole. There are no leg buds. Okay, an eye is larger here and smaller here, and this one has just one eye. All right, so now some of the, and this is the study from Carrasco showing, again, it was not published in the United States. Originally, it's glyphosate-based herbicides produce tetragenic effects on vertebrates by impairing retinoic acid signaling. Okay, so remembering that slide there of the tadpoles, here is a baby again I'm showing you with no arms or legs. This is a child who has actually differently sized eyes. It might be a little hard to see. And then the worst of all, which if you need to close your eyes, is something else that's been found, a one-eyed human baby. They die very quickly. These are shocking, all right? Now you might say, oh, this is just happening in Argentina. Well, surprise. Now you remember I told you about the small head on the glyphosate-exposed tadpoles. And so here we have, in the United States, a lot of confusion about something happening in the Yakima Valley, where it went up 8.5 times the amount of encephaly in Yakima Valley. This is what Yakima Valley looks like. It even looks a tiny little bit like Marin to me and the water district. And here is, this is where some of the glyphosate came into the water here. Here's an American baby born with encephaly. There have been quite a few of them. And then if you close your eyes, this is another one that was born in Washington, but it's really intense. You can close your eyes if you can't handle it. Okay, we're off. I only showed them a little bit. So the EPA, when Monsanto heard about these things in Yakima, they went to the EPA and they raised allowable glyphosate pesticide levels in food by 3,000%. Okay? The allowable levels in the European Union are 0.1 micrograms per liter. The allowable levels in the United States are 700 micrograms per liter. And in the Seralini study where they did these rats that had these huge mammary cancers taking 25% of their body weight, they used they tested, had the rats drink some water and not eat GMOs, with just a little bit of Roundup in it at 0.07 micrograms per liter. Considering the U.S. allows 700 micrograms per liter, this is 0.07, that's a huge difference. Also, if we were to use Roundup, trying to get it out of our water isn't what the MMWD thinks, that it just requires a reverse osmosis filter. You have to have clinoptilolite and humic acid in a special filter. It's actually quite expensive. So when I saw the situation, in Washington, they're totally confused about why there's been an uptick in all these babies. And what was said is the pesticide companies decided to do their own study of the mothers. And they looked at whether the mothers were taking enough folic acid, different things. And they were avoiding the testing of the water. And the nurse who originally reported this uptick was told to be quiet. So there's a lot of confusion. There's parents that are saying, look, they said, we don't want to take this further because we don't want the parents to feel badly about producing this kind of baby. So we'll just look at their medical records. We won't even interview them. We'll look at their medical records. They must be so sad about the baby. And then there was another mother who heard this, and she said, look, I want you to interview me about my baby and what happened, because I don't want this to happen to other American women or parents. So another thing that shows up where the CDC is completely confused is on Clostridium botulinum in farmers, Monica Kruger. And when you read the CDC report, they are so puzzled that this particular disease, chronic botulism, is showing up in rural areas. Like, how could it be? Well, what happens, as I told you before, is that Roundup increases the growth of toxic bacteria in the watershed, in the soil and wood in our watershed. The last thing that was discovered just very recently was the link to cancer of the lymph, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. This one is in the mouth, showing up. And the research articles on this are showing that showing up in farm workers using glyphosate. Okay. Now, please remember that the amount of glyphosate we would need to use in the Marin Water District, because Scotch and French broom have a woody trunk, is more than what you find in a GMO field, okay? So getting back to the kidney disease and taking a look at it a little bit, we have Sri Lanka bans Monsanto herbicide. That was their first response. We have the kidney disease. We have the reports in some medical journal articles. Here's an international journal again. You don't find it in American journals. Ignacio Chapella was not allowed to print his information on the spread of GMO crops in Nature magazine. So Nature and science are not the be-all and end-all when it comes to studying pesticides in the United States, all right? And GMOs. This is just a little thing that they made. Here's the worker spraying glyphosate with the backpack sprayer. He gets some dermal absorption, some inhalation, unless they use respirators, okay? Then this is from Sri Lanka. There it goes into the watershed and it's picked up by plants, a fertilizer. It bonds with some of these metals, somebody drinks water, and then once it enters the body, here we have the release of glyphosate, AMPA, and heavy metals into the kidney. It would take the arsenic that we have in Marin soil, going to the oxidative stress, apoptosis, which means death of cells, necrosis, degeneration, and decay, into glomerular sclerosis, glomerular collapse, etc., and ending up in death. Okay? So, now, the Marin Water District has significant amounts of serpentine soil, much like Sri Lanka. And I want to say, when I talked to Swayze of the Watershed District, he said to me, we seem to see that you're opposing our methods, and I think we need to record every phone conversation we have with you. I was just trying to get a copy of the draft EIR, which finally came through. But, they do see me as a threat. Glyphosate backpack spraying and sponging and the risks to Marin County. Basically, they are, when Lisa Cross says we won't be spraying, she means helicopter spraying. She doesn't mean backpack spraying, and she doesn't mean sponging. Now, what they were going to do is cut the broom and then sponge it, and they have to use a very high concentration of glyphosate in that, and it goes down through the roots and then communicates to other plants through the roots. So, anyway, and I was just, again, really surprised when Liza had never heard what happened in Sri Lanka. We're showing significant residues in the urine of humans. As I said, I've done some testing. We have some significant testing of higher levels in Maui, where I've done some. I'm just starting on Marin to begin testing urine levels of glyphosate. The weed whacking herbicide, this is showing up finally in Scientific American, after a number of years. This is a very recent study in the Food and Chemical Toxicology. Again, it's an international medical journal, and they're showing that the herbicide has an estrogen receptor that can mediate breast cancer cell development at one part per trillion. I'll show you the exact study in a moment. This is the kind of tumors that showed up in the Seralini study. As I said to you, Monsanto attacked Seralini within 24 hours, and they got a new editor in the magazine and got the retraction of Seralini's study. The females lasted the longest with these mammary glands. These were all the males that died. Okay? The males died quick. This is a kind of cancer that is a similar human cancer. This is this was shocking to me. This came out from Thailand, a study in Thailand, that this can cause and stimulate breast cancer at one drop in one part per trillion. And when I went to say, well, what does that mean? I looked on Wikipedia. One drop in 20 Olympic-sized swimming pools. Now, look, if you get exposed to a carcinogen, you don't know if you're going to get cancer. There's a delayed effect. How strong is your immune system? So it's very hard to track, okay? But again, in my opinion, this calls for the precautionary principle. So these were some of the things that I sponsored with my nonprofit Environmental Arts and Research. Different than Sunrise Center, because if I brought this out, or my application in my Eco Retreat Center in Maui, now is controlled by Monsanto, it might really hurt me. So I used Environmental Arts and Research, but we found 10 times higher levels in the United States. And this is some of the environmental risks in Marin County, some things I didn't really understand at first. I'm constantly studying with these guys. I mean, it's been like since 2012, and even with some things Larry added, I added to this. So So the first study about how phytophthora, and I cleared it with Don Huber today before coming to really understand it even better, is how does glyphosate stimulate sudden oak death? Well, it really does it most by harming the friendly bacteria in the soil and allowing disease-causing bacteria to proliferate and hurt oak trees. Because bacteria, just like in our intestines, they all live in a dynamic relationship with each other. So it increases Phytophthora, Fusarium, Pythium, and Rhizoctonia. And these are the kind of bacteria that can help kill oak trees. Now, they would be in more control if they were balanced with Pseudomonas and Bacillus. So I didn't write that in another one that I don't remember. The other thing is it hurts the immune system of oaks and other plants because it chelates the mineral needed by plants to have a strong immune system. And the minerals are manganese, copper, cobalt, zinc, magnesium, all of these, calcium, nickel, and iron. So it gives them, as has been labeled, a bad case of AIDS, so to speak. Here, here's a picture of the Marin Water District with Bontempe Lake and Lagunitas Lake seen below. This is all serpentine soils in this area. Here is the proposed possible spraying. This is Phoenix Lake here, Lake Lagunitas. This is Bontempe. No, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Okay. And this is Alpine, right?
Right.
And this is Kent, okay?
So the proposed degrees where
Well, they're going to spray in, they said originally they were going to only spray in level 5, but to up the cost of it, which I'll go into in a minute, they increased number 4, and Larry's going to talk to them. So one thing that I learned recently from Don, which I didn't understand at first, was that glyphosate acts on serpentine soils in two ways with plants. And the first thing it does is it creates a sealing of the soil so for a little while, so the plant can't absorb water. So the plant is becoming dry and brown and increased fire risk, okay? Then the next thing it does is it destroys the bacteria, you know, that are the good bacteria that support the plant. And then another thing that it destroys, because it's an intense antibiotic, glomulus fungus that produces the glue in serpentine soils especially, that holds the soil together and would reduce the risk of landslides. Okay, so when the water finally gets through, because there's very little aluminum in the soil will have a chance to slide down the hill. There are many hills in the Water District, as you know, and we've all seen the effects of mudslides. This is one where a man lost his life here in Marin. So there's another thing that I would like to say in contrast is the fire district in Marin is supporting the risk of fires. It will be, you know, we got to get the Scotch broom out, but glyphosate will cause death in many plants and increase fire risk for the reasons I told you before. Here's a picture of the oak wilt, which is when the oak can't absorb water. Here's some examples of glyphosate-caused sudden oak death and oak wilt. A California oak from right here in Marin, big fire risk. Here's a bush that got exposed to glyphosate and it started developing scorch disease and dying. It was not sprayed. And so getting back to the Marin Water District, we have these large strands of broom. Here's a picture of Larry studying carefully what would happen to the oak tree, which, you know, dead oak is definitely considered a fire risk. And you can see there's lots of broom plants right around it. This is us looking up that hill again. And this is a picture of 25 Scotch broom seeds that were on the road alone, 15 feet away from the plant. Just on the road, 25 seeds, okay? So one thing, the water district thinks that it won't take very long to get rid of it, but they don't see. When Don Huber walked through, he said this could take 40 years of spraying herbicides, and at a much higher rate, because they are a plant that has a woody stem. Okay, so this is now some new stuff that I brought in. This is in the draft EIR, page 83, and how they want to convince you is they want to tell you that it's going to cost a lot more with conventional herbicides. So come on, you know, get with it. This is a lot less, okay? And this is, and so they're saying this is the economic benefits. Let's go with it, but they don't take into account the damage to the environment. Far more money. Okay, this is right. Thank you, Larry, for helping bring this out. I mean, it's what I read briefly, but he picked out the pages. I was so happy and tried to show it to Spotswood. This is the suggested herbicide use, page 99, draft EIR. Okay, they recommend a low amount of glyphosate. They talk about backpack spraying, okay? And see the word sprayed? Okay?
Who exactly is they?
The Marin Water District. This is directly from their draft EIR. In writing.
Okay. It's not the consultant, it is?
No. It's from Lisa holds these up. I can hold it up too. Okay? All right, so further, and again, thank you, Larry, for picking out the pages. These are this is actually from the Aquamaster label package. And they are saying that always use the higher amount when weed growth is heavy or dense. The weeds are growing in an undisturbed area, okay? Now, what do we see in that water district, okay? All right, then treat it heavily with dust. You'd have to put in more. And they recommend just trying to get little weeds like this. It'll be most successful on that. You can pull that out with your hand. Okay, and then to make aquatic applications around or within, Okay, so I looked at what you do in a water district. Do not apply this product within 0.5 miles of an active potable water intake in a standing body of water, such as a lake, pond, or reservoir. Give me a break. This is on Monsanto's product insert, page 4. Okay.
Well, all streams carry the water straight down into the
right
bodies
and,
of water.
And
so
backpack spraying. Yeah, we're almost
like 5 miles away.
All right. So anyway, so in terms of another plan, and I'd like Larry to speak to it for a few minutes. This is using goats, volunteers, paid laborers. Charge maybe a little bit on the water bill for non-toxic management, experiment with an organic herbicide, drop seeds of a well-growing legume. And this is this is something Larry showed me about a whole other way of managing this that would be much less expensive than that proposed by the water district. This is, you know, a safe biodegradable herbicide that can be used with some things. In terms of the goats, the grand jury reported that goats would eat the madrone. So you can attract the goats by spraying molasses. There's some goats. This is an idea from Don Huber about planting a competitive native legume that can grab some of the nutrients from the broom when the seeds are restarting. And finally, I'm getting to Larry, who I'd really like to talk. And our life expectancy is very high in Marin. Let's keep it that way. Let's keep Marin's water district safe for recreational hiking and ourselves. Let's keep Marin safe. If you want more information, like my bibliography, which is continually expanding, either email me at this number or go out to check our blog on our website. So that's the completion. And I'm very happy to have shared with you. And Larry, could you come up for a little bit? So, just to say one more time, Larry, and come forward if you could. I am really impressed by your study of this. And I live in Tiburon. I can't even vote for you. But thank you. So I'd like you to get some perspective from Larry.
So I'm not there. On our website, on the campaign website, I don't want to make a campaign speech here, but we did publish detailed answers because I submitted detailed, there was a detailed questionnaire that all the candidates submitted to the Pacific Sun and the Sierra Club. And I published on my website the answers to the Pacific Sun, which was kind of my second draft of really answering a lot of these questions. So there's very detailed information there. But, you know, I guess just in a nutshell, the money saved by the district is far offset by the potential cost to community health. And that's really what the campaign is about in a nutshell, is healthy watershed, healthy community. And this is an investment not only in the health of the community, but our economic vitality, because water really is the basis of our ability to live here and have a good, long, healthy life. So, as far as the specifics on the cost of using glyphosate, if you really take apart the numbers in the Marin Water District study, according to their own study, 90% of the watershed is not infested with broom. It's about 10% right in the Fairfax watershed. And by their own study, that it's so infested that it's impracticable to try to eradicate broom in that area. So it's not they are not even considering trying to eradicate broom, but yet in calculating the cost comparison between conventional pesticide eradication of broom versus organic, what I'll call organic eradication, they include the number for the part of the watershed that they admit it's impossible to eradicate broom, so they're artificially inflating the number. Mm-hmm. So that's, if you go to the website, that's kind of, that's brought out and emphasized.
Can I ask a question? The water you're speaking of, the source, what in-home testing has been done of the bioaccumulation of glyphosate and dioxins?
That's a good question. I don't know. There is an annual report that the district does publish. I don't know if it includes an analysis of environmental toxins or not. I know Commonweal out in Bolinas did a study of bioaccumulation in Marin and found very high accumulations in, you know, very healthy people. So this is, you know, glyphosate is a ubiquitous contaminant in our environment, among others. So I don't think any of us are particularly protected from exposure. It's universal. It is the largest pesticide, herbicide used in the United States. There's almost 1 billion pounds of it manufactured.
You're saying that I'm specifically talking about the water that's distributed to the homes that's consumed by the tenants of that particular home, not how much of it is in the outer atmosphere. That's something to go after and start to eliminate. You're never going to get rid of all the toxins in the world as it goes around the world.
Right.
The problem is, what do we have in front of us, and how do we take care of what we can manage?
That is a very good question. And again, I mean, the only thing I can point you to as far as a study of the water quality here is they do an annual water quality report. And I just am not familiar with
this.
What level? Just what levels do they study that? That's the problem with this.
Yeah,
that's been reported that it wasn't bioaccumulation.
I'm going to have to get back to you.
Lower levels, it is bioaccumulation.
Yes. Yes. So, any other questions that I can answer?
So, are they using glyphosate now, or have they in the past?
They were using it in the past, and what happened was a couple people from Fairfax saw them in backpacks up at Sky Oaks. Fairfax Town Council passed a resolution urging them to stop spraying, and eventually that's what led to their temporary moratorium on spraying. So they've had a temporary moratorium probably for 7-8 years now. But how it began was that they were seen using it. And this is, you know, this is very common in land management here in Marin, whether it's Marin Open Space, the Park District, the U.S. Park District. You know, we have a lot of overlapping land management agencies. And, you know, our campaign, just briefly, is the watershed should be sacrosanct from those type of toxic pesticides because we're getting our water from it. So it's different than parkland, rangeland, open space. So we want to keep it pristine as possible. And certainly we don't want to expose the population. We want to use the precautionary principle.
So right now, there's still no more spraying?
As far as we know, they're not spraying now. That's
okay.
Correct.
They're trying to do it again.
But this study seems to be sort of marching towards this cost-benefit analysis, which really, you know, you're internalizing the savings and externalizing the costs to community health. So it's not a good way to calculate the costs. Okay? Thank you.
So I really want to encourage you to hold this information. You've learned something that is not easily available, and I'm now just handed by Kate that you went to the CDFA meeting and they would like to stop. This would be called a forum on pesticide or herbicide uses in California, to stop them legally, and to also, it would be hard to believe they could succeed, but to stop or EIRs.
See, people don't
know about it. Somebody sent it to me, and my friend and I went to the second to the last meeting in Sacramento. There was not one member of the public other than me. Huh? People don't know about this. They're just trying to push it through. But they're calling this the final EIR to end all EIRs. And they're serious. We heard this woman from the CDFA talking about all the pesticide, herbicide they're intending to spray for invasive species, etc. Wow. And we're not going to be allowed to say anything.
How shocking.
It is.
Yeah. Well, I was really shocked when I was talking to Master Gardeners. And I said, I've decided I'm not going to use Roundup after watching the movie The Silent Forest. Which is an incredible movie I recommend everybody watch. And after I watched that movie, I decided I'm not going to use it again. I said, what's the alternative? And she said, well, we're funded by the University of California, Davis, so we have to recommend Roundup.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. There's Master Gardeners in Marin County.
Amazing.
And I couldn't believe what I heard.
Wow.
And then, I furthered the discussion and she said, well, there is an alternative. You could use boiling water.
Well, this is shocking, and I consider that some of the information that Kate and Malcolm are delivering is really precious. And I'm going to try to be an ongoing container of information and updates on my website, so because I'm very concerned.
Could I just say one other thing? There's actually a fundraiser today in Fairfax because
yes.
we challenged, they were gonna spray the Bay Area for the light brown apple moth. This was another threat conjured up by the CDFA that this light brown apple moth was gonna devastate California agriculture. And we fought it. This was aerial spraying. And we fought it, and they finally backed off implementing. It was a massive urban spray program for the entire Bay Area. Well, they didn't do the spraying, and lo and behold, the light brown apple moth has not devastated California agriculture. We're still eating our fruits and veggies. I don't even know if there's been a report of any kind of significant damage from this little species. And we litigated that case. That case went through Sacramento Superior Court because that's the home turf of the CDFA, California Department of Food and Agriculture. Mm-hmm. And you know, the judge kind of just did not make a ruling because the judge found it was moot because they had withdrawn the program. We're appealing that because we challenged it on the basis that their EIR, Environmental Impact Report, was inadequate. So, to make a long story short, that case is pending. There's a fundraiser in Fairfax 13 Meadow Way at Frank Egger's house, who's really been a leader in the Stop the Spray movement here in the Bay Area. So this whole effort by the chemical industry, by the big ag, big chemical industry, it's an ongoing thing. And you know, our little watershed is really one small piece of the puzzle. Mm-hmm. So it's really something for everybody to be aware of.
This is their answer to your fight. This is what the light brown apple moth spray fight, they don't want that to happen again.
They don't want to
and
happen
And I have again. On here state, federal, because that had to do with trade agreements. Homeland Security was putting the bill for the light brown apple moth spray.
Right.
And you know, it uses phenomenal amounts of water to spray.
That's true.
Yeah. 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 We did research on it, the light brown apple moth. There are trade agreements, whether it's NAFTA or some of these other trade agreements, where it can really be used as a political ploy. Oh, we're not going to accept your produce because you're not spraying for this particular species, and we are. And I actually published an article on that. That was basically, will trade law trump public health? And that really was kind of that. Really, at the end of the day, when it turned out there really was no threat,
yeah.
You know, this was just a program of fear and deception.
And now we have the. Who was head of Homeland Security during all this is now, I don't know if she's president or chancellor.
UC.
What's her name? She was head of Homeland Security.
She was Janet Napolitano.
Yeah.
So there's, you know, you got to stay aware and stay on top of it. And challenge what you're being told and what you're hearing.
But we need comments by October 31st and then signs.
Yeah, well, I will bring this to France.
Okay, I'll give you some others.
Sure. Okay.
Yeah, excellent. So Larry's going to be in France if you have more questions.
Well, I'll bring some of those to France and we can...
mention
this. If you have other people who haven't decided what they want to vote for,
you know
bring
what
them
I was
along.
Thinking? Send this along to the United Farm Workers because it's those
people
who get
sick. I mentioned that
I He's in district number 3, Larry.
So for
water board.
Any of your friends that live in Woodacre, in Kentfield, in Fairfax, San Anselmo, that's Division 3. Tell them they can vote for a good steward of our watershed, Larry Brighton.
So thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.